Oh, my beautiful hair. That's what you call wash and wear and go to bed. Bedhead. Swish cheese. Sorry, Ashley. That's probably... What do you call it? It's probably rude of me to eat cheese in front of you. I wanted to just respond to Ashley's thing before I watched Colissa's thing, because I don't want to forget what Ashley was talking about. I really appreciate your perspective. I really appreciate that shift in a perspective. I think of it like the Google camera, the Google Streets camera on top of the cars, and how they can take a picture from every single angle that the car's camera can see to give you a full 360 view. And every single one of those camera pieces on that camera is important. Without every single one of those cameras working, you miss a piece of the larger picture. So I might have this perspective on my end that's not invalid. It's not shit. It's not even wrong. I have my own perspective on mom and what I think and what I feel and how I'm approaching this. Maybe it is wrong. I don't know. But I have my own perspective. It's maybe one of those cameras. Where you, I think you've got a lot of cameras. I think you've got a lot of perspectives. Something that kind of like helps complete the overall picture. Calissa's got a camera too. Maybe she's got more than one. I'm not here to analyze how many cameras people has. But you understand what I'm saying? Like, we all bring a different perspective to the same situation, which is really helpful when you're trying to get a full picture on what's the best approach. I really love what you said about mom's love language and what works for her and your comparison to training your dog and how the spanking and the negative reinforcement just does not teach your dog how to stop chewing and how to behave like a decent fucking dog. You have a really good point there, because we just practiced this not too long ago, April 9th technically, when we were trying to help mom learn the computer and figure out her taxes and do what she needs to do to apply for unemployment. And by doing everything for her, kept mom enabled. By doing everything angrily, kept mom down. By doing everything pitiful, you poor thing, mom, that didn't help her either. Do you know what I mean? Her love language was encouragement. Her love language was much like your dog, positive reinforcement. And I sat there with Colissa. I think I just sent it to Colissa, right? I don't remember actually seeing that, Marco Polo. But I sent it to Colissa, where you go from this pitiful, sorry for herself woman who's just really down on herself about the whole situation to a happy, laughing, joking mother who is excited about the future. All in a matter of what? I don't know, 30 minutes, an hour? I was not filming the whole time, but I kept coming back and showing more and more positive outcomes of how mom's disposition was changing because of my positive reinforcement, because of the treats I would give her, the words of affirmation that you said that she needs. So I really appreciate you reminding me what approach works best for mom. Now, with that being said, I also appreciate the other thing you said about Keith and Ramona and coming from pure trailer trash and look how well they've done for themselves considering all they wanted. All they wanted was better for themselves than they got as a child. And even though mom's not trailer trash upbringing, you're right that she didn't get a chance to express herself emotionally. You're right that she didn't get a chance to be honest with who she was, and she was taught to be codependent to others for, even in the sake of her own truth, even in the sake of her own desires and her own dreams. You know what I mean? She never learned how to speak up for herself until much later in life. I'm gonna eat my pasta now. I'm on my lunch break and I don't have very long. And even though mom's not providing the ultimate lifestyle for herself right now, she's also not trailer trash, and she's also not Morman trash. Meaning, she has provided us this opportunity to grow and to learn from her mistakes, and she did give us better than what she got. She gave us a voice. She gave us the opportunity to search for ourselves what we want and follow our own dreams and follow our own path and not do the Morman way and not do what everybody else wanted us to do. We all got a different perspective of this Google Streets camera. But I love how we're bringing it together and getting a wider picture so that we can come into an understanding. So let me go back to what I was saying. With all that being said, mom tried calling me yesterday, and I'm like, yeah, I wasn't very kind. I wasn't loving, and I wasn't sweet, and I wasn't patient, but I wasn't angry. Like, I wasn't telling her what I felt. I wasn't making her feel bad. I wasn't doing anything to her. I was indifferent. Maybe I came off as cold, whatever she wants to call me. But I was really mindful of what you had told me to not deal with her right now. And I need to take care of my own mental health, right? So when she called, she said that she's not coming over again. I said, okay. And she admitted to me finally that she fell off the wagon. I said, okay. And then she said, oh, you must hate me. You must be so disappointed in me. Do you love me? And I recognize that. I recognize that from 10 feet away. My mom has been teaching me. Mom has been teaching me for years not to fall for Jim's manipulative bullshit. Mom has been teaching me for years not to fall for those tricks where he's feeling down and he's feeling insecure and he's going to make me feel bad because he feels bad. It's like, no, Jim needs to get over his own shit. Jim needs to take care of himself. No amount of love and attention and no, mom, I'm not mad at you. I'm not going to lie to her. I am disappointed in her. I'm allowed to be disappointed in her. I'm allowed to be mad at her. That's my camera. That's my perspective. That's where I'm sitting from. Would I like to broaden my perspective and change my view so I get a larger picture? Yes, and I appreciate that. But yesterday when she called me, I was in my narrow-minded one perspective of it all, and I'm allowed to be there. I'm allowed to have that. I don't need to change who I am so that mom feels better about herself. Does it help her? No. Does it help her grow? Probably not. But I'm not her sponsor. I'm not her keeper. I'm not her caretaker. I'm her daughter. And she doesn't get to be codependent on me, or I don't get to be codependent on her, trying to make her better, even though I don't... No, I'm going to speak my truth to her, just like I'm speaking my truth to my husband. My husband may be paranoid and fucking retarded, but that doesn't mean I've got to lie about how I feel about him, just so he feels better. And just the same with mom. I don't need to lie and tell her, no, mom, I'm not disappointed, just so she feels better. And if I would have told her the truth, if I would have told her, yes, mom, I'm disappointed in you, that would have just been her excuse, the excuse she needed to continue drinking. So I didn't tell her anything. I said, mom, don't tell me what I feel. Don't tell me what I think, and stop it. And she kept doing it, and she kept saying it. So finally I said, I gotta let you go. And I would not buy into the manipulation. I would not buy into the tricks. I would not buy into the pity party. Was it wrong? I don't know. But I'm telling you where I'm at emotionally and mentally, and I'm trying to stay within my strength with it and not fall for the BS. So when she's texting me, she's trying it again, and I go, stop telling me how I feel. I believe in you. You can figure this out. You can do this. Because she can. I know she can. She does not need me to come and rescue her. She does not need me to come and save her. If Ashley wants to be her caretaker, if... I don't know. But as a daughter, I'm too close to it, and I can't fix it for her. It's the whole reason why there is Al-Anon meetings. There's the whole reason why there is codependent meetings. Is I have learned that enough to know that I can't fix it for her. So, now I'm going to finish my cheese and pasta, go back to work, and I'm going to listen to Calissa's video in just a second. Love you guys. Bye. I'm still eating my pasta and cheese. I just finished watching Calissa's Polo. Thank you, Calissa, for your childhood experience and sharing that. I didn't get it like you did. Similar, but not to the extent you did. I remember it being hard to watch mom take off. She not only did it in Tucson when she was married to Keith, but she also did it when we were living with dad. She'd show up in town and she'd be really sneaky about it. And sometimes she would sneak off and go visit people and not visit her kids. She'd be staying across the street at Debbie's house, across the street from dad, and not even tell her kids that she was in town. When I found that out, it was really heartbreaking. There'd be times where she'd want to take just me out and she wouldn't want me to tell you or Christopher that she was in town. And I felt like I was getting a special moment with her, but at the same time, it felt like I was robbing you guys of an opportunity as well. And then when I was a teenager and she would just sneak out of the house and we'd have to find out from Keith that she was on another trip, I remember feeling like we weren't important to her. I remember feeling like it didn't matter. I remember getting conflicting feelings because she'd come home and she'd shower us with gifts, or she'd spoil us, or she'd buy something else, and you know, for herself or whatever, and she'd have all her excuses in the world, and I was just supposed to accept them as fact that she didn't want to wake us, and she didn't know that she was leaving until the last minute, and she loves us, and this is what she has to do for money, and so yes, it stinks, but look at how great she can provide for us because she's able to do this sort of job. And of course I didn't know either what she was doing, not until I was an adult and living outside the house. And I got so mad at her after dad died, because I knew there was a paycheck from Social Security office that was coming in the names of each of the children that he had. And because she was my custodian, my guardian, my mother, she got to cash that check and deposit it and use it for how she saw fit. And because she was taking care of us, she was entitled to that. Yes, I agree. But not knowing how much money she was getting for each trip, and not knowing what she was doing, from my perspective, I just saw a new swimming pool. I saw a new couch set. I saw new drapes. I saw a new carpet. This was all right after dad died. And I thought to myself, something's not adding up here. I'm almost 17. I'm almost 18 years old. I don't get this check for the rest of my years. I only get it until I turn 18. That means I only get 6 months of this money that should technically go to my college fund, or heck, I don't know, my lunches at school or something. But I wasn't getting a dime of it. I wasn't going to see a dime of it. And all I saw was all this new stuff for the house. So in my perspective, I got really angry with her. I went behind her back. I called the Social Security office. I told them the situation. I told them that she's getting checks for three of us kids. My stepmom's getting the other three up in Utah. I'm going to be 18 years old soon, and I don't think this is right. What can I do? And they told me that because I was old enough that I could request to have it put into my name, and the checks would be made out to me, and as long as I caught the mail in time, she couldn't cash them. And so I did. And of course, mom found out, and she got pissed, and we had a big screaming match, and I was mad at her for months about it. And she was mad at me for being mad at her and tattling to the Social Security office and putting her at risk for getting caught for what she was really doing and what she was really doing to get that money for the pool and the drapes and the couch. In hindsight, it was all really silly, but at my perspective, it just felt like she was selfish. It felt like she was not thinking of everybody else. You know what I mean? So anyways, that was the start of my anger with her, because when I was 11, 12 and she took off to Arizona, I was in pain. And I didn't have any anger about it. I was just in pain and sad and disappointed and confused. And 3 years of my teenage years go by and not knowing how to deal with the fact that my mom's happiness was more important than mine. My mom's happiness was more important than keeping her vows to her husband and Beaver. My mom's happiness was ever fleeting, like you've said, Calissa, and she just didn't really see the value in holding to her commitments of being a mother and being a wife and being an employee. I mean, she's always chasing someone else to make her happy. So as a confused child who just longed for the oxytocin, like you've said, Calissa, that's a great perspective, that's a great way of putting it. I also needed stability, and Dad and Rosanna provided stability, but Rosanna didn't provide that emotional peace that we were good, you know, and that we were valued and that we were loved. Dad did his best. I don't think he did a spectacular job either, but I know he always struggled with trying to do his best. Mom was doing her best too, and considering where she came from, I understand more so now than ever why her journey took her on the journey that she went on. And then you get to the point where we're finally able to go live with her, and I quickly saw that she's got all these hats on, she's juggling all these pieces, she has all these kids, and I had to find my place in that and just take what I could get. You know, get the love and the attention from mom when I could get it. She would constantly talk about her own mom and how her own mom was always busy and the best way to talk to her was on the toilet. So, okay, I guess that's the way it is. But after the whole fiasco with the paycheck, I was like, you know, I don't have to understand her or love her or agree with her right now. I get to be mad at her and that's okay with me. But it didn't feel good, of course. It didn't feel good to be mom's enemy or someone that mom victimized herself because of my anger, you know? It's like, no, I get to be angry, mom. You don't need to make me feel bad because I'm angry with you. But I didn't know my voice then, so what I've discovered recently was instead of allowing myself to have my feelings about mom, instead of allowing myself to be disappointed or hold my boundaries or let go of that oxytocin, I have been ever so codependent on to her as well by making sure she thinks I'm happy with her, making sure that she's okay all the time, making sure that she knows I'm not mad at her, even if she's disappointed me, even if she's made me angry, even if she's upset me. I have basically had to shove my feelings down because mom can't know that I'm upset with her because she'll just victimize herself and make herself feel worse or blame me for her unhappiness or whatever. And that's not healthy either. So that's where I'm at with all that. I just wanted to share with you my perspective again, not like just piggybacking on what Calissa was saying, and I don't need to go into the whole thing again, but I'm allowed to have my feelings about this, and I don't want to be someone that prevents her from getting better. So I'm not going to call her and yell at her and make her know how I feel. Sorry, that's annoying. I'm not going to make her know how I feel and release all my anger and tension. I don't need that. I don't need to do that to her, and I don't need anybody to know what I'm feeling. Do you know what I mean? It's not my agenda to make her feel bad. But I get to own my feelings, and I get to be in my space right now. So I appreciate you, Ashley, for telling me to take care of myself mentally, my mental health, not to unleash it on her, which I haven't. But I'm also not going to rush and save her and fix her and make her feel good again. I've done that all my flipping life, except really that one time. Even after she left and went to Arizona, and I'm 12 years old, and I'm using the basement rotary telephone, and I'm sneaking a phone call, a long-distance phone call to talk to her. And cry to her. I'm so sorry, sweetie. You're not mad at me, are you? You're gonna be okay, right? You're all right. You have your mommy. She's just a phone call away, right? Yeah, mom. No, I wish I would have been able to have my voice and to say, you know, it's not okay, mom, and I don't appreciate you acting like this and being like this and discarding us like we weren't important. I don't appreciate it. I wish I would have had that voice. I'll say one last thing, and then I'm gonna go. I don't know, it was a week or two or three ago, I don't remember what it was, but me and Jim were having a screaming match, and we were yelling and screaming off the top of our lungs to each other, and it wasn't pretty. This is, of course, before I moved out of the bedroom. Once I had my wits about me, actually, I think it was right after. It was that night I cut my hair. So it was over a month ago. Doesn't matter when. But anyways, it was a while ago. And got my hair cut. I cut my own hair. I just deleted all of my Facebook friends, which, as you know, was super a big deal to me. And obviously a big deal to Jim, because he didn't want me having Facebook. And I was just feeling really down about myself that I let myself get that out of control with my anger. That's what happens when you stuff your anger and your resentment down and down and down, and you don't allow yourself to feel it and express it, is that it explodes. But what I was saying is, I know the kids had hurt us. It was no secret that me and Jim were fighting. We were in behind closed doors, and we were doing the best we can to, of course, leave the kids out of it. But when you can hear it from another room, and you can hear how ugly it sounds, and you can just feel the tension, I don't want that for my kids. I think that's terrible that me and Jim are like that. We're like that. We're not doing that no more. Now that I've moved to my own room, I feel like I'm speaking my voice. But what I'm saying is, after I cut my hair, I went into Brooklyn's room and I hugged her and I apologized to her and I told her that this is not okay. And I'm really sorry that she has to be any part of witness to this ugliness whatsoever. And you know what she said to me? She says, "It's okay, mom." I said, "No, sweetie. I know you're just saying that. I know that's something everybody says. I know that's a condition we all have, is to say it's okay. But it's not okay. It is not okay that me and Dad are fighting like this. It is not okay that you are able to hear it or that we're even fighting to begin with. None of this is okay. And I don't want her growing up thinking that this is okay. And I don't want her feeling like she has to make it better. She has to make me feel better about what she heard because she's young and resilient and able to take it like I took all mom's decisions. No, I made poor choices and my daughter shouldn't have to suffer that. It is not okay. I am not okay with that. She shouldn't be okay with it either. It's okay that we're not okay with the way mom is. So anyways, we get to this point in the conversation where we can open it back up again or let it rest. I like that Colissa was asking Ashley for guidance on what to do next, because I also would like to know what to do next. And if Ashley feels like this is too much of a burden to take on, you don't have to take it on either, Ashley. I know you've kind of put yourself in that position by saying that you will, but you are her daughter as well, and you're allowed to have any feelings that are coming up for you. You don't have to look at her like she's a patient, but if that helps you, do what you need to do is basically what I'm saying. I'm not telling you what you're doing is right or wrong, but you do get the right to have your feelings, and you do get the right to have your emotions. Anyway, I'll talk to you later. Love you, bye.